This is Levi Clay reporting for Guitar Interactive magazine, and I'm sat with the legendary Nuno Bettencourt. Nuno, nice to see you.
I'm good. I'm doing okay. Yeah.
So you're here in London for the incredible Pornograffitti tour, right?
Well, incredible says you, but yeah, it's the Pornograffitti. Yeah, we're definitely doing Pornograffitti tonight.
Yeah. How's the reception been thus far on the tour?
You know, it's been really good. It's interesting because we get a lot of the same fans that show up, but definitely there's a lot of people that I haven't seen you in 20 years, people, which means that probably since Pornograffitti, they haven't come to see the band. So that's kind
of
cool.
Yeah, it always seems like a bit of a touchy subject amongst the real fans, because obviously Pornograffitti is such an amazing album, but people neglect that you had amazing albums that came after that with fantastic material. And in Soundcheck tonight, nobody wanted to hear any of the Pornograffitti stuff. They wanted Hit the Day and Warheads.
It's interesting. Most of the meet and greets that we do, I would say 90% of them always talk about every album but Pornograffitti. Yeah. They talk about Three Sides, they talk about Punchline, and you know, and they like, a lot of them like Saudade more than, you know. So look, I mean, it is what it is, you know. Yeah. There's no best album contest between us. So it's cool that, you know, look, there are fans and then there are fans.
Yeah, it's been certainly a ticket to success anyway, so you can't complain about that.
Yeah, it's good.
Regarding playing any of that, all that stuff live, just for my own interest, are there any songs that you play live from that album that you, moments in the songs that you happen to dread pulling off live, or is it still a breeze playing that stuff?
Yeah, the whole thing's a nightmare.
it's
interesting, there's a lot of guitar on that album, and even a lot of guitar where there should be no guitar. There's like stuff. When I was listening to it, trying to kind of catch up on it, but I couldn't believe how many whittly bits I was doing in between vocal lines, and anytime I could sneak something in.
Yeah.
I try to do most of it, you know, as much as I can through the night, and I try to stay pretty true to the record, but there's a lot of stuff on there that's just like, you know, I don't know how cohesive it was on the album itself, you know, like playing a section and then going to another section, because I think sometimes I didn't leave much breathing room for the for the horn section, if you know what I mean, to actually make it like this, so they could actually pull it off.
Yeah. Well, I think the defining part of that album and your sound in general is your influences. You kind of got that Eddie vibe going on, the Van Halen thing, but you're so funky, obviously. Could you talk to us about some of your earlier influences when you were growing up and guys that sort of brought that out in you?
Well, oddly enough, you know, when somebody thinks about funk or they think about an influence like that, they're always referring to the funkier bands, you know, the Parliaments, and obviously Prince. I was influenced by Prince a lot, and I mean, there's an album that I worshipped, this Rufus and Chaka Khan album. It's called Stomping at the Savoy,
okay. Which
is like, if you ever want to hear some great stuff, it's... But truthfully, I was always attracted to that, even in the bands that I... rock bands that I loved. I've always saw the funky, or heard the funkier side of Aerosmith, and even Queen at times. Pat Travers was a big influence of mine for that, for rock kind of funk thing. But even Zeppelin, you know, I always caught a lot of the funkier stuff that they did, and I was more attracted to the rock that they did in that way. Van Halen as well.
Yeah.
Van Halen was funky to me. As like, probably nobody would ever say that out loud, but there's elements, you know.
Yeah, he's a rhythm machine.